Okay, now, are you indeed the leader of the United Nawabi Nation?
No, but I'm the founder of the Nawabi. That's another hoax. The idea for Mr. Howard Richards Seals and the Lord Slant and defamation of character, by the way. I'm not the leader. They look on Sun Ra's album back in the 60s. They look on, what's his name, Pharoah Sanders' album. You'll find in the back of that album, the word Uwapo was already there before. And this book's written back in 1963. And on record in Washington, D.C., behind the nine balls, quite available, that they don't have me down as the author or the publisher or part of that publishing company at all. Follow? There are many Nawabis. I'm not the chief or leader of all Nawabis. There's Nawabis all over the place. There's some Muslims, some Christians, some Yoruba, and some atheists, for that matter. And I'm not the leader of all Nawabis, nor am I the leader of the whole organization of Nawabis worldwide.
What is a Nawabian?
I'm not going to ever define that word to anybody, you know why? Because that's the question I'm putting before them. You keep referring to us as Nawabians. My question to them is, what is a Nawabian? And if you say a follower of Malachi Seahawk, that's not a definition. What is a Nawabian? Because if you call a Christian a follower of Christ, it's because his name is Christ. So you can't call Nawabians followers of Malachi, or they would be called Malachiites, not Nawabians.
Mama, right? I had to leave that boy alone to get my mind right. I had to leave that boy alone to get my mind right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I had to leave that boy alone to get my mind right. I had to leave that boy alone to get my mind right. Yeah, yeah. I had to.
Man. Where do I begin? Wow. Let me say this from the beginning, okay? Nuwapu is not the doctrine, philosophy, or science of Malachi York. You know, as you heard in the audio that played in the beginning, this guy said that it was slander and defamation in character to call him the founder of Nawabians, the founder and leader of Nawabians. Man, where do I begin? Let me start here. In the back of the first three books I wrote, there's a quote that says, the Ethiopian race is not only physically captive to mankind, but also captive to his cultures and inventions. This means woolly-haired people are mental captives to adverse forces as well as physical. Mental captivity is the worst kind of captivity because it means that the captive is mentally dependent on the captor. Mankind is all peoples with straight hair by nature. If we need something, we must work and get it or create it. So long as we remain mentally dependent on other races to do our thinking and plan our progress, this is how long we will remain in the ghettos and slums and the poverty and diseases that they produce. The reasonable and practical worldwide solution is mental liberation, which produces Ethiopian creativeness, the ability to create everything we need, and Ethiopian independence, the ability to think independent and act independently of other races. A person, place, or thing is alien to us Ethiopians when it is not of and for us by nature. A person, place, or thing is in the nature of whoever created it. The nine ball liberation information. It was that quote, and not just that quote, but that series of books, the nine ball count 1 through 4, and Bible interpretations and explanations books 1 and 2, as well as Introduction to the Nature and Nature books 1 and 2, which motivated me to write the books that I wrote. I was under the impression that the nine ball counts 1 through 4 and Bible interpretations and explanations were written by Malachi York. And I was under this impression because he said he wrote them. You know, he used many variants in the spelling of the name Amanubi Rakapata on the front and covers of his books. But on the insides of several of his books, he said that as Amanubi Rakapatah, exactly as it's spelled on the front of the books from 1967 to 1971, it says, as Amanubi Rakapatah, I also released a series of books called Behind the Nine Ball and Bible Interpretations and Explanations. So, I believe he wrote these books. Those books were so influential and inspirational to me because it was the first time that science was presented as a form of spirituality. Inside those books, Bible Interpretation and Explanations book 1 and 2 and the Nine Ball count 1, they describe a philosophy called Nuapu. Alright, and I'm going to define what it says about that philosophy in those books, but the description of that philosophy is a scientific form of spirituality. Now, as a person who was a lifelong scientist, you know, a scientific form of spirituality, you know, was very inspirational to me. I was like, oh, wow, you know, science can be a form of spirituality. So those books motivated me. And because I thought those books were written by Malachi York, the first one came out in 1967. Malachi York was born in 1945, which means he would have been 22 years old when he wrote those books. You know, I was like, oh, wow, he wrote something like this at age 22. I was coming into this realization at the time when I was 27. I was like, wow, okay, well, I need to get to work. So I started, you know, I started writing my books, and I put my first book out at age 28. Which was Supreme Mathematics, African Math Magic. Then I wrote Thai Technology. And then I wrote book one of the series, which was The Science of Science and the Science in Sciences. Again, that title was inspired by part of the definition of the word Nuapu. How I titled those books, Science, Math, and Technology, SMAT, SMAT, that was inspired from the Introduction to the Nature of Nature books. But he uses the acronym SMAT to represent space, matter, and time. It's just interest aside, note that, you know, you can describe all of nature and the application of nature with the same letters. If you can describe all of nature with the letters STEM, space, time, energy, and matter, and you can describe the application of, or the study of nature with the same four letters, science, technology, engineering, and math. That's just an interesting observation. But back to my point, because I don't want to digress too much. But, so I believe that these books, which contain this scientific philosophy called Nuapu, were written by Malachi York. You know, the narrative that they were giving at the time, that the Malachi York's organization was giving at the time, was that, you know, he wrote these books in the late 1960s, early 1970s, and people weren't ready for them, so he had to start teaching Islam, and he lived a life of lies and taught Islam all through the 70s and 80s, and then finally he realized that people were ready for Nuapu again, so he came back and he renamed his organization Nuapu, and he started teaching Nuapu again, and so that's why he had all this other stuff, you know, the Sumerianism and the Islamism and the Kemetism all wrapped into his narrative, because his whole purpose was to give people Nuapu, but people weren't ready for Nuapu, so he had to give people what they wanted until we were ready to want what he had to give, which was Nuapu, which he tried to bring in the early 1960s. And that was the narrative, you know, that was being repeated by Malachi York's organization at the time. But as far as I was concerned, you know, the doctrine of Nuapu, that scientific doctrine of Nuapu, that resonated with me more so than, you know, all the alien talk and the Anunnaki and all that other stuff. You know, all that stuff about aliens and Anunnaki and Planet Risk, like, that makes for fascinating, entertaining science fiction, you know, but it should be left in the realm of science fiction, with the understanding that fiction is another word for not true. But, you know, as a teacher, I recognize that, you know, sometimes you have to put sugar in the medicine. Sometimes you have to, you know, you have to dress up, you know, a concept that might not be as readily acceptable, you know what I mean, in order for people to accept it. So, you know, it made sense. Okay, well, maybe he, you know, he had to add all this extra dressing to the concept of Nuapu in order for people to accept it, you know. But it was that scientific doctrine of Nuapu that resonated with me the most, more so than anything. There was a interview on 6 Dynasty Media on the YouTube channel called 6 Dynasty recently, and it was a long interview. It was like a debate almost that went on for six or so hours. And one of the topics that came up in that debate was the identity of Aminubi Rakatata, the person who wrote the books which introduced the word Nuapu and this philosophy of Nuapu to the world. And the brother made the point that the same person who is Afro Ono, who was the writer of Introduction to the Nature of Nature, was the same Aminubi Rakatata who wrote Bible Interpretations, Explanations, Books 1 and 2, and he was one of the writers of Behind the Nine Ball, or not, it's not entitled Behind the Nine, but it's entitled The Nine Ball, Counts 1 through 4. And so, you know, a few years back, it was always a debate about whether or not Malachi York was Afro-Ono. I never believed Malachi York was Afro-Ono, but I did believe that Malachi York was Aminubi Rakatata because he said it, and I didn't have any reason to doubt that he was or wasn't. But when you read the works of Afro-Ono, which was Introduction to the Nature of Nature, and then you compared it with the books of Aminubi Rakatata from 1967 to 72 or 3, you could see the similarity. And so, and then you would ask yourself the question, well, you know, if York is Aminubi Rakatata of the 60s, but he's not Afro-Ono, but there is a very strong similarity between Afro-Ono and Aminubi Rakatata, then, so even though York said he was Aminubi Rakatata of the 60s, it never really sat right with me. It never really made sense to me. It never reasoned out. You know what I mean? And so, and if it turned out that York was not this person who he said he was, then he's not only is he caught in a lie, but the very foundation, what he named his organization, the name that he chose for his organization, the purpose that he chose for his organization, was all stolen and taken from someone else. So I reached out to the brothers, the brother Ty Noon and the brother Anute, and you know, they told me all of the research that they've done, and they're in contact with Afro-Ono's widow. They're in contact with the family. They're in contact with the family of the other writers of the Nine Ball. And I mean, the evidence that they have is compelling. And Malachi York did not write those books. And so why it's so important is because that is the foundational cornerstone of his entire doctrine. And it's not even his. It's another concept, just like Moorish science, just like Islam, just like Kemet, just like the Sumerian thing, just like, you know, just it's another doctrine, another philosophy that was taken and stolen and amalgamated into this narrative that he weaved together. It's not even his. It never was his. He took it, and so after writing in so many books that he was Aminubi Rakatata, who introduced this concept of Nuapu to the world in the 1960s. After Malachi York saying that and writing that in several books, now he has an audio from jail saying he didn't write it. He's not the writer or part of that publishing company. And then there's a letter that says, next thing they're gone. I ask why and I'm told some lie, when in fact I am not the Aminubi of BIAE, which is a acronym for Bible Interpretations and Explanations. I'm just a messenger sent to renew the truth. That's all. He, meaning the author of BIAE, Aminubi Rakapata, is the head of Nuwapu, one of the elders who guides my pen. I am what people want me to be. I did not write BIAE or Behind the Nine Ball. I only renewed it. So he didn't. So now he's confessing he didn't write it after all this, and that this guy Aminubi Rakapata, who wrote these books, he's the master teacher's master teacher. Oh boy. So it's not Malachi Yorks. So who is it? Whose is it? Who introduced that to the world? Well, you know, as previously mentioned, it was one guy who wrote several books. You know, Nuwapu was a science and philosophy introduced in the mid-1960s by this man, Johnny Eugene Brown, who wrote under the following pen names: Aminubi Rakapata, Repo, Nubi Repo, and Afrono. And he was one of the three Wunupu, Nabanupu, and Asanupu who authored the Nine Ball. Those same three brothers, Wunupu, Asanupu, and Nabanupu, are also the same three brothers who were listed as the publishers in the Introduction to the Nature of Nature books, as Oripu, Sipu, and Gipu. And so the total books, the books that we know so far that this brother was responsible for writing, were Bible Interpretations and Explanations circa 1966 and 1967, which is the first and earliest appearance of the word Nuwapu. Bible Interpretations and Explanations Book 2, 1968. The Nine Ball, Count 1 through 4, circa 1971 to 1972. Are You Searching for Knowledge? If so, read Me, Moonset and Sunrise in the Nature of Nature, 1973, and then renewed in 1993. Then Introduction to the Nature of Nature, Book 1, 1993 by Afrono. Introduction to the Nature of Nature, Book 2, 1995 by Afrono. Transcript to the Audio Tape of the Nature of Nature by Afrono, 1996. And then Introduction to the Nature of Nature, Book 3 by Afrono in 2007. Okay, the concepts that were stolen out of these books and mixed and amalgamated into Malachi York's narrative are the concept of Nuwapu, the concept of nine ether, the concept of six ether, three ether, the concept of the spell of Leviathan, and he completely stole the identity. It's beyond plagiarism. He assumed the identity of Aminubi Rakapata. It's crazy. So you can't take York's words on any of those subjects, right? You know, in all fairness, if you want to judge those topics, Nuwapu, nine ether, six ether, three ether, the spell of Leviathan, you have to go back to the original works of the original author. And if you subtract these topics from Malachi York's narrative, what's left? What's left? You know, we know the Sumerian thing was coming from Zechariah Sitchin. You know, this whole part is coming from, you know, another author. What's left? The Riskian part? We know the Moorish part was coming from another source. Like, what's left? Once you take this away, what's left? And the evidence is coming out. And so the reason why we say that Bible Interpretations and Explanations is circa 1966 and 1967, because you know, the version of the book that most people have that is circulated, which has the first and earliest appearance of the word Nuwapu, is dated 1967. But then there's an excerpt from the book in a 1966 version of the Liberator magazine that the brother Anoop shared with me, and you see Aminubi Rakapata, who wrote a letter to the editor, which was an excerpt from that book. So that book was in existence, or at least he had a version of that book in existence in 1966. So let's talk about the history of Nuwapu prior to it being taken by Malachi York. What did the original author have to say about Nuapu. So Nuapu, as defined by the original author in 1967 to 1971, he defined it as knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. All knowledge, all wisdom, all understanding, finite and infinite, right knowledge, right wisdom, understanding. He said the standard knowledge of Nuapu is right knowledge. Nuapu is universal knowledge. Nuapu is the science of sciences and the science in sciences. Nuapu is the science of the original creative forces, the science in which and with which the universe was grown, the science of sound right reasoning. Adherents are the sons and daughters of sound right reasoning, the science of evidence, experience, and reason, the spiritual science of the African Pygmies before the flood of Noah 17,250,000 years ago. He also says in those books that Nuapu is the best knowledge, wisdom, and understanding, and Nuapu is the Ethiopian's equalizer anywhere and anytime, and it will be disclosed when the minds of woolly-haired people with the ability to identify themselves with Nine-Ether have been qualified. The booklet's Bible interpretations and explanations are sufficient to qualify with, if accepted diligently, studied, as well as read. These books are dedicated and designed to separate the wheat from the tar, separate those who can make it from those who cannot make it, those who are not flexible enough to reform and conform to right knowledge through sound right reason will not survive Armageddon, the showdown between right and wrong. And he also says that these books, Bible interpretations and explanations, are not the science of Nuapu itself, but the diligent reader and diligent study and profound understanding of these booklets will open the mind and tear down the barriers and qualify the mind for the universal science called Nuapu. So that's what he said about Nuapu, you know, through those three books released from 1966 roughly to 1971. All right, then he comes back in 1993 with a philosophy called Noon, a science called Noon. And Noon is basically defined the same as Nuapu, is basically defined the same as Nuapu. One, he says Noon is the science of all knowledge, all understanding, and all wisdom. Noon deals in correct information. You know, in the introduction to Nature books, he uses the phrase right knowledge less, and he uses the phrase correct information more. He says Noon is nature and universe science plus reason. Noon is the science of sciences. Noon in its fullness is the science of science, the pioneer of science. Noon is the original and ethereal spiritual science of Nupu, the original creators of the universes. Noon is the science of sound right reason. Anyone who studies, learns, understands, accepts, propagates, promulgates, advocates, and practices Noon is a descendant of sound right reason. Noon is information which has been proven true by experience, experimentation, examples, evidence, or reason, or any combination of these factors. Noon is the science of the original flesh and blood gods and goddesses who produced the Africans. And he adds one additional thing to his description of Noon. He says, Noon in its perfection is called Noponoon, which means that, so that's science. He said that said Noon by itself is not perfect, but there is a perfected form. So that's science. That means that Noon, that means you can find some fault. You can find some flaw. You can find something that's incorrect in it, but as it refines itself, it heads towards Noponoon. That's a scientific philosophy. In science, we're always seeking to refine our understanding and explanations about nature. So that's the original definition of Nuapu, you know. And so one question that, you know, I know people will have is, well, if he's the one who actually came up with this concept and authored those books, then why didn't he ever challenge Malachi York, you know, on the use of it? And, you know, and I mean, I don't know, but, you know, I can think of some ideas. For one, this brother was born in 1926. So in 1967, when he came out with his first book, or 1966, 1967, when he came out with his first book, he was 40 or 41 years old then, right? By the time you get to the 90s, when York is using the word Nuapu, it, you know, this brother is in his mid-60s, You know what I mean? So what is he supposed to do? You know, drive down to Georgia and confront him in his mid-60s? You know, I mean, he probably wrote a letter, but he probably didn't even... I mean, that's probably one of the reasons why he had to, you know, come with a new word called Noon. But at the same time, you know, when he first introduced Nuwapu, you know, he had that phrase in there where he was like, you know, this is just a qualifier. You know, this is not it. I do plan on coming with something later. So, you know, maybe he wasn't even really sweating it, you know. Another question people ask is, why was there no mention of Bible interpretations and explanations of the Nine-Ball in the brother's obituary? Again, you know, you have to understand, you know, so he came out with his first book in 1966-1967. He was 40-41 years old. He met his wife, or he married his wife in 1979. They met in 74, right? So you know, his widow, who was responsible for taking care of the obituary and everything, she wasn't there to witness, you know, the writing of those books. Now, he may have told her about it, you know, but what she was there to observe, that's what was included in the obituary. So that, you know, that might be one explanation for it. But I mean, there's so much more evidence above and beyond that. And this brother Afrono, or Aminubi Rakapata, and you know, his two partners, they had a small group in New York. They used to pass out their books at jazz concerts. One of the early followers was Leon Thomas, which is why, you know, on Leon Thomas's first album entitled Spirits Known and Unknown in 1969, you see the word Nuwapu Publishing. And several other albums, you know, that Leon Thomas released, he uses that same word, Nuwapu Publishing. You know, in York's audio, he says Sun Ra and Pharoah Sanders. It wasn't Sun Ra and Pharoah Sanders so much. It was Leon Thomas. And Leon Thomas, when he did a feature with Pharoah Sanders, and so you see Nuwapu, because it was Leon Thomas on Pharoah Sanders' album, you see the word Nuwapu on Leon Pharoah Sanders' album. I couldn't find any albums that had Sun Ra featuring Leon Thomas or Sun Ra with the word Nuwapu on. I couldn't find any evidence of that, you know. But, you know, Nuwapu Publishing was Leon Thomas. That was his thing. And then you had a reggae music group called Nuwapu featuring Teddy Powell, and they put out several albums. Now, as far as I know right now, you know, I don't know if they had a connection with this early group. We do know that one of the three brothers, Sipu, he had family connections to the Caribbean and Barbados, so it's possible that there was some connection there, you know. But as of right now, you know, we don't know, you know, if there was influence from that reggae group from these original three brothers. But that's Nuwapu. That's Nuwapu prior to 1990, prior to Malachi York getting his hands on it. You know what I mean? And so you can't call what Malachi York taught Nuwapu. You can't call followers of Malachi York Nuwapians, because, you know, to do so would be to continue to perpetuate Malachi's York of identity theft against the original Aminubi Rakapata, who was Afrono. You know what I mean? You can't call what Malachi York taught Nuwapu no more than you can call it Moorish science or Islam or Kemetology or Ansarullah or Yamasi or Sumerian. You can't call what he taught any of that, because all of those doctrines were taken from other sources and amalgamated into his narrative. You know, it's, you know, it should be called Malachiism or something. You know what I mean? They should call themselves Malachiites, like he said on his own audio. You know, call yourselves Malachiites. a good analogy would be to say that Malachi York is to Nuwapu what Adolf Hitler was to the swastika, right? Because in its original expression and manifestation, the swastika had a positive interpretation, right? And then Hitler took it and weaved it into his Nazi narrative, and now it took on a negative connotation. You know what I mean? And the same, York did the same thing with Nuwapu. You know, he took the word and he labeled his whole organization with it. He said he was the person who put out the books that introduced the word, and it's a lie. It's a lie. And so, you know, you have people who are coming out as sexually abused or physically abused victims, but there are many more people who are mentally abused by outright lies and deception. You know what I mean? And it's like, right knowledge, right wisdom, right understanding, sound right reason. What about right morality? What about telling the truth? You would think that somebody who had right knowledge would also have right morality. You know what I mean? I met a lot of good people, a lot of sincere people who wanted to who did their best and wanted to do their best to help black people. They did work in the community, you know, intelligent brothers, you know, hard-working brothers, industrious brothers, beautiful sisters, you know. In Atlanta in the mid to late 90s, early 2000s, things weren't like they are now. Now, you know, it's commonplace to see women with natural hair, but, you know, in Atlanta in the mid to late 90s, early 2000s, if you saw a woman with natural hair, 9 times out of 10, she was into the whole Nuwabian doctrine. Or if she wasn't into it, she knew about it. You know what I mean? Like, that's just the reality, man. There was good, sincere people. You know, you can't build what they were able to build and accomplish the things that they were accomplishing without having good, sincere people around you, hardworking, industrious people around you, productive people around you. You know, it's just unfortunate that the foundational cornerstone of the whole thing was a lie. You know what I mean? I was on the Nuwapianism website. And there's an article on their website that says something like, ask the Nuwapians, why is there no mention of Aminubi Rakaputar prior to 1990s? And I remember this. There used to be like a Facebook group, you know, a few years ago, and I remember this coming up in the Facebook group. I don't know if they had the website then. And I never commented on anything on that, but that was the one thing, because I was like, I chimed in and I was like, this is probably the most important thing to discuss, because it deals with the foundation and cornerstone of the whole thing, right? If York is not Aminubi Rakaputar and he stole that from somebody else, then you can't say they follow Nuwapu. That's why there's always this logical disconnect. You know what I mean? That's why there's always this logical fallacy, the argument. Well, if y'all deal with right knowledge, then why do you believe this, 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 and this? Because the right knowledge portion of the doctrine was taken from one source, and the other portion of the doctrine that's not right was taken from another source. You put them together, and they conflict, of course. What do you expect? You know? And so in the addendum to that question, why is there no mention of Aminubi Rakaputar prior to 1990? Why is there no mention of Nuwapu in any book prior to the 1990s? Why is there no mention of Nine Ether in any? All of these concepts like that have become associated with Malachi York were stolen. All of that stuff, man. So, you know, we're dealing with people who are the victims of mental abuse. And, you know, when you listen to the stories told by the victims of the physical abuse, you know, they were victims of physical abuse, which means somebody actually touched them. And it still took them time to come to the realization that what happened was wrong. So, and that's physical. So, of course, because mental abuse is a lot more subtle. So, of course, when you're a victim of mental abuse, you know, it's going to take more time to come to the realization, dang, what happened to me was wrong. That was wrong. But, you know, being able to say, you know, I was wrong is one of the hardest things to do in life. And believe it or not, that's science, because in science, especially early in the beginning, you make many hypotheses that turn out being wrong. You make many hypotheses that turn out failing. You know, science is a very humbling endeavor. You know what I mean? Because part of the learning process is making a failing hypothesis. Now you know what's wrong. Now you know in being wrong, you learn what not to do. So there's still added value in that. And that's a part of the science. If science is your spirituality, making a failing or a wrong hypothesis, it will happen from time to time. But and as a scientist, you learn from the experience and you correct yourself. You correct yourself so that you don't make that mistake again. And what happens over time, as you refine your process, you start making less and less mistakes. You start making less and less errors as you learn the patterns and what to expect in nature. You learn how to make more conservative hypotheses so that when you are wrong, you're not so wrong, right? So, I mean, that's all a part of it. That's all a part of this scientific form of spirituality, you know? But when you are able to say, I was wrong, and you make an effort to correct your wrongness, you know, people appreciate it. You know, people appreciate it. And people will forgive you, you know, if what you did was not so wrong that it was unforgivable. And, you know, for me, I need to say I was wrong. I believe that this man was the person who put this idea of Nuwapu, this scientific spirit form of spirituality, out into the world. I believed it. I accepted it because he said it. And I didn't think he had any reason to lie and make that up, you know. But I was wrong. Who does that? Who assumes the identity of somebody else? You know, I was wrong. And I even looked up to him and saw him as a hero for a certain point of time. Like, I was like, man, they were able to accomplish all this, you know. That's motivational, that's inspirational, man. Who knew that it was all a lie, man? That's unfortunate. But, you know, I do hope that, you know, those same good brothers and good sisters, those same sincere brothers and sincere sisters, man, that I met that were members of the Nuwapian organization, if they're still members, or even if they care. I know a lot of people just left and moved on. You know what I mean? They left it alone. But, you know, I do hope, you know, when all the facts and everything, all the truth comes out, man, they'll stand on the side of truth. You know, they'll stand on the side of truth. You know, one thing I'm left to wonder is that, you know, I recognize how much, you know, the definition of the philosophy of Nuwapu, you know, being scientific minded and letting that be my form of spirituality, I recognize how influential that was on my mentality. And I'm left wondering, would I have still arrived at the place that I'm in now had it not been for the beautiful pictures in the books that came out of Malachi York's organization, and the buildings on Tamaray, and the, you know, the productivity that I saw in their culture. I wonder, would I have ever been interested in investigating the content of the information had I not seen, you know, all of those beautiful structures and those beautiful images first? You know, that's something that you know, I question, I wonder, you know. But yeah, man, you know, when you're dealing with victims of a form of abuse, you know, there's a certain level of care that has to be taken, you know, when dealing with them, man. Just like you wouldn't approach, you know, somebody who was a victim of, you know, any kind of physical sexual abuse with a level of brash brashness and arrogance. You know, you have to say, wear those same kid gloves. You got to, you know, have that same level of care when you dealing with somebody who is a victim of mental abuse. You know what I mean? Because they're dealing with the same thing. You know, that was one thing from Malachi York that I never agreed with. He used to say, "Only fools duck when the truth is thrown at them." And I always would be thinking to myself, but why does the truth have to be thrown at somebody, bro? Why do you have to throw the truth at me? You know what I'm saying? If you really want me to get the truth, just walk up and hand it to me. Here you go, brother. Here's the truth. You know, that's like saying only a stupid hungry person would duck if I throw bread at them. But why you gotta throw the bread at my head, shorty? You know what I'm saying? Like, why you gotta throw it at me? Why the need to have such a brash and aggressive approach? If you really want me to receive it, just walk up and hand it to me. You know what I'm saying? Right knowledge, right wisdom, right understanding, sound right reasoning, but also right morality, man. People have to have right morality, you know. Yeah, it's an unfortunate situation. It's a really unfortunate situation. But I think I said all I want to say about this topic. Peace.